For millennia, the four nations have lived in harmony. A peace made possible by the Avatar. The one person with the ability to master all four elements and protect the delicate balance between nations. When one Avatar dies, their spirit is reborn into a new body in an eternal cycle. Since the death of the last Avatar, the new incarnation has yet to emerge. And so, Fire Lord Sozin, the ruthless leader of the Fire Nation, believes this is his moment to launch a merciless campaign to conquer the world. His first step is to eliminate the one person who could stand in his way. The next master of all four elements, an airbender, who may not be ready for the responsibility of becoming the Avatar.
She's so persuasive, that marijuana, she's so nobody, I won't tell nobody, yeah. Tell her she wears those. Now she want me pool cut, so me pool cut. Tell her she wears those tools. You see, it's obvious, it's obvious. And she takes on up. What didn't I do for you, girl? And I know, and I know, and I know. I don't know for you. Love like a riddle, yeah. Give me that truth for the riddle. Oh, wow, oh, that's a little, yeah. Life's pretty sweet, can't be bitter. This one she fine, oh, yeah. She want this, but she got this. She know if we control them, yeah. She dance it, she wind it. She make me want give her body. Back shots, body. Give her body, back shots, body. Give her body, back shots, body. Wow, 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 wow. She live where I jump for NYC. Big girl, she can eat the best I see. Steady, ready, me assassin. Sweet in my belly, you're like cake, I saw pink jelly. Eggplant emoji. So train when I slide it. Now she watching me like telly. Sensational. What did I do for you, girl? And I know, and I know, and I know.
Miss you when I pull up on my tech concept. But put it wider than the internet. I'm a presidential if you're also fast to lose. Goody goody, get a goody goody bam bam. I need you now now, put me on fire like a lantern. Can you taste so divine? And I wonder why you so
sensational.
March, which means that Q1 is almost over. And I was looking through my 2024 mood board, vision board, schedule, just to do a little check-in, and I realized that, you know, we need to recalibrate, we need to re-strategize, and we need to make some changes to what we got going on for 2024. So I definitely feel like for January and February, I definitely took it easy. I was kind of in that hibernation mood, where I just took it easy. It was just really chill. And now I'm like ready to get back out there, get better with my productivity, get better with my scheduling, making sure that I'm on top of everything because time is flying. It is almost April, pretty much. This week will be the 15th, so we're almost halfway through March. Time is flying. So I wanted to have an honest productivity chat and walk through my mood board, how I did my vision board, how I did my scheduling, because I need to do a whole reset for that. So yeah, stick with me here. January and February were more chill, calm months for me. It definitely served as the 2 months where I did a lot of reflection and I came to a few revelations of how I was kind of organizing my life and what I do want to keep doing and what I don't want to keep doing. I know we have all been inundated with the productivity vlogs and videos and level up and self-care and how to be that girl, how to transform your life in 2024. All of that stuff has been flooding our timeline since the beginning of the year, and I definitely realized that I need to take what I can actually utilize from some of that content, and a lot of it is kind of fluff. And one of the biggest takeaways that I discovered is that you really have to tailor your productivity goals, your life, organization, whatever, to what suits you, and be very realistic and be honest with yourself. When I made my little 2024 vision board, mood board, I was not being honest with myself. Not in the ways where I was being too aspirational with like my dreams and like major goals that I wanted to hit and stuff like that. No, like shoot for the stars. But when it comes to everyday like practical things. So I will take you through what I have so far and let's see how we can rework this schedule. So this is my 2024 overall mood board, vision board, kind of daily schedule tracker, life organizational tool. So I like to use Milanote, which is in short kind of a more visual friendly Notion. Tried Notion out, but it just didn't give me the visual aspect that I needed. I like how I can kind of collage things, add my little notes. There's so many different things you can do on Milanote. I'll quickly show you how you can do that. So if you go to board, you can drag that into your board. So I dragged a new board in and I'll quickly show you the different templates that they have that I feel like are super beneficial. For my 2024 mood board schedule, I obviously selected mood board. If I wanted to do a creative brief, you know, pitching to a brand, client, or just organizing a creative brief for myself, I could essentially use this template, which has all the necessary info that you need to make a complete brief. Client, background, goals, deliverables, references, assets, timeline, stages. And so for weekly plan, I did use this last year on a weekly basis to kind of organize my day to day. I didn't keep up with it too well, and I noticed that I don't really do well with like daily check-in, check-off type things. That's not how my brain works. I kind of like to do the overview and know my day to day and just let it go like that. But if you need something that's more structured, this board definitely helps. Storyboard, I also really like. This is great for planning out video content because you can break it down shot by shot, Add in your inspiration images if you do like to scout locations when you're shooting things.
Okay, so underneath my overall mood, overall goals of the year, I have kind of my day-to-day scheduling, day-to-day productivity things that I want to get better at or be more consistent and disciplined with. The first thing that I have is mastering a morning and a night routine. And this is one of the revelations that I had over the past 2 months, is that I don't have a good morning routine and I don't have a good night routine. And I think the reason for that is that I don't kind of necessarily see my morning and night routine as this calming, ritualistic practice. It's very much based off of efficiency, and it's kind of just a mandatory habit that I have to do in order to upkeep everything. And I don't look at my morning and night routine as that, like, calming, wind down, restart in the morning type of thing. It's not that for me. So I'm kind of thinking that I need to re-strategize and rethink about how I would do my night routine, morning routine, and how it will work for me. I think that keeping it efficiency based, keeping it consistent will work. And I think for me, I find like the calmness, the more experiential side of a morning and night routine, more relaxing when I am getting services done by the people. So I think that part of my morning and night routine is going to be geared towards getting like services done. So making sure that I am going to the spa at least once a quarter. Hopefully I can get back to doing it once a month, maybe just blocking out a day, going to bathhouse, going to Equinox, just finding a day to have that sense of calmness that I don't necessarily do in my morning and night routine, if that makes sense. So staying in that lane of routines, I have a little list here of my personal beauty maintenance routine, the things that I like to do that are mandatory for my personal upkeep. This, I don't think I have to change too much. I'm pretty consistent with it. At least I was for the first 2 months out of the year. Brow fill-ins, lamination, quarterly sew-ins, maintain my press-on nail routine, need to put them back on. Quarterly pedicures, let's change that to monthly. Because I normally do my pedicures at home, but I could do monthly pedicures at the spa or something. That always works. Daily and nightly skincare, quarterly massages, we'll change that to monthly as well. And then maintain at-home lashes. That's something that I will consistently keep. I'm not paying for lash extensions anymore. It does not even make sense anymore. But beauty, skin, nail routines, all that stuff, like, that's pretty consistent. I have not really wavered on that, so that's good. So the next thing that I want to add is the daily schedule. I realized that I need to start blocking my day out hour by hour. Just too much idle time. And now where like I need to be doing something every second of the day, it's just like, you know, those hours after work, if you're not doing anything, like that can pass you by, and that's time that could be utilized. So when I check my work emails in the morning, I need to do my email responses back from brands and any PR, anything like that, that relates to the content influencing side. So that needs to happen in the morning, let's say around 7 a.m. So during work hours, I don't have too much time or too many breaks throughout the day. A lot of it, of course, is in meetings, fittings, all of that stuff. So I like to schedule like posting for Instagram, TikTok, whatever, around 11 a.m. to noon. And I need to start utilizing the scheduling feature a lot more immediately, so I don't get backed up with content. I think responding to comments, engagement across all platforms, I think around 5 is good for me. I think that'll work. I could do that on the commute. So the tricky part is once you get back home from work, or if you get back home from happy hour drinks, whatever events, that time until you go to bed, that's the time that I need to specifically block out for things. So I want to regulate cooking to nothing over an hour and a half. I do like to do a lot of editing throughout the week just to make sure that I'm not falling behind on anything. So I do like to block out maybe 2 hours for editing, and that's for YouTube content, Instagram, TikTok. I'm gonna add a little note on the side here where I need to remember to organize my outfits for the week on Sundays. Save time that way. I do also like at the end of the night prepping for anything that I have to have ready for the next day for work. Just like a quick scan checklist, make sure all emails are answered, everything's prepped and ready to go for the next day. So we'll leave it at that. This is a good working schedule where my time is handled way more efficiently than it was before. Okay, I think I'm gonna quickly show what I have in my different categories and buckets for my 2024 mood board, because I don't want this to be a huge long segment of me just scrolling on my computer. So for the home section, I just have all of my little inspiration images for decor, different little things that I wanna get. So I have little inspiration images. So like, for example, this pink bookcase, I love the lighting design here. So I want to have that on one of my living room walls, kind of something similar to that. I have one of my favorite photographers, his work, Wolfgang Tillman. I wanna recreate something like this in my bedroom. We have the projector inspo images, because I'm doing a projector in my living room. Of course, we have the iconic Peggy Gow's house in Berlin. I love her decor, I love her whole setup there. We have a little bit of a sample room here, so we have to figure out how to make that happen in this apartment. Inspo images, more photos in my space, I wanna do more of that. Definitely getting more elevated serving ware for hosting. And just taking, I put a note here to romanticize the art of food presentation and taking pride in how I present things, how I plate things, even like little things that I cook or little things that I snack on. I want all of that to be elevated. So the next one is social media goals, social media mood board, vision board. We have some YouTube stuff over here as inspo to get more consistent on this platform, which I honestly have been enjoying so much. Like, I literally think I had like Instagram and TikTok burnout. Like, I don't know, TikTok is just not like interesting to me anymore. I don't find it like interesting to post on anymore. I mean, Instagram's always been like that, but Instagram is Instagram, like whatever. But TikTok is just like so, it's just so redundant to me now. It's not like fun. Like, I don't enjoy like posting on there that much anymore. Especially with this like impending TikTok ban, like I really want to know what's gonna happen there, because like I feel like we all could use a break from TikTok, to be honest. I feel like long form content is a lot more interesting to me. I think I'm having way more fun editing it, playing with things, being more experimental. I don't want to get stuck in a format quite yet, at least for the next like 6 months. Then once I have a format that works, that I think my audience responds to, then we'll, you know, keep it consistent there. This section is like hobby, so I have a book club, which I need to join one. There is one that I'm thinking about joining. I think they have a meetup or a meeting this month. But if anybody has New York City book club recommendations, please let me know. I realize that I am not a casual reader. Like, I can't do the 2 chapters on the train and put the book down. No, because I can read a book in what, 2 to 3 days. Like, I, when I read, I want to like read. And that can't happen on a weekly weekday basis. I don't have time for that. So I'm kind of regulating my book reading to the weekends. And possibly maybe doing like a 2-hour block if I have free time during the week. But we have a few memberships that I'm thinking about joining. A few that are on here I'm already a part of. Okay. So this is where a lot of my time I think will be taken up with this year, and I'm not mad about it. So let's break it down. So we have getting back into dance classes. I danced for majority of my life, and I wanna get back into ballet and get back to my old capabilities of ballet. So that's definitely a priority this year. I believe we'll do that. I want to say May or June, we'll start a summer session with ballet. So my current exercise schedule right now is Monday or Tuesday, we go to the gym or we do a dance class. Wednesday I do bar. Thursday or Friday we do silks. And if you're watching beforehand, I did include a little snippet of my first silks class that I took. And that thing is hard. I think that's one of the hardest things I've probably have ever done. So Saturday mornings, yoga, and then Sunday mornings, yoga. So that is our current schedule right now. We have some solo travel destinations here. And then painting and animation classes, which I think based on the way that my schedule is looking like for spring, might have to be a summer decision as well. Like a summer, early fall type thing. I really wanna get back into the fine arts painting world. Like in college, I definitely had to learn it for my degree, and all of my sketches that I did in college were watercolor paints. So I definitely have a lot of familiarity with painting. Like I wanna get my muscle back with a lot of different things that I kind of neglected as, you know, you get into your career, life starts to pick up. Like I wanna tap into those like natural talents that I had. So that's the goal for this year. And I think that is it. Popping back in because I actually have two new things to unbox. One thing is gifted, one thing I did buy. So I want to unbox that on camera and show you guys, and then also explain this outfit. I didn't get full details on it, but let's get into that now.
So I'm wearing this vintage St. John's jumpsuit. It's a knit jumpsuit with this color blocked yoke in green. The rest is black. It's an oversized fit, very reminiscent of the classic St. John's 80s era. Of course, you have your gold little dome buttons here and then a matching gold zipper pull. I normally wear this jumpsuit during the holidays because it screams Christmas, but today I want to be cute and comfy, a little work from home day, so why not wear St. John's while working from home? Oh, baby girl.
Taking somewhere tough, tough of us, she making love. She on the stage with everyone. Yeah, yeah, she tough. Whoa. Just cop the merch to show support. I hope she's kicking it up. All
these years are the same. So the first pickup are these real calf hair black mules from SCHUTZ. These are the Nylor mules in black. So I was scrolling looking for the Alaya embellish flats, belly flats, mules, whatever. Got those are coming soon. And these popped up on my little Google search. I got a size 10, which is true to size. They fit really well. They're super comfortable. I think these retailed for, I want to say 200. Got them at Nordstrom. These are definitely reminiscent of the Togepula, like heavy embellished buckle
MULES that were super popular like around 2 years ago. I definitely was gonna get me a pair of toga pullas, but I don't know, I just never got around to it. But I think these are good, and these will also work for the whole cowboy reemergence that we're gonna see for the spring and the summer after a certain someone drops an album. So yes, these work.
Her friends, I guess, WV. Took the weave out and left it short. It still look hella good to me. I'm your secret biggest fan, it's different. We kick shit with everyone. I need some more intimate.
So I was also kindly gifted a Teddy Blake bag of my choice. And I chose the Stella Vitella style. It is a ruche gathered clutch, and this is in the color dark beige. And it's super cute. It's really compact. It has that classic old school rounded edge for the clutch. And then you can also use the strap for a crossbody. I think I will keep the strap tucked and use it just as a clutch. I think for spring summer, my thing is going to be tapping back into clutches and some of the older clutches that I have. I think there's just something really cute about like using a clutch for like your everyday bag for like your errands instead of doing like the top handle bag or the crossbody or a tote. Just do a little clutch you can just tuck under your arm. Like that'll be so cute. Running your little errands, or like when I go to a lot of my like exercise classes and my fitness classes and stuff like that, like instead of doing a tote or a big bag, just like a cute little clutch just to run around the city and stuff with. So I really like this style, and I'm glad I picked this one, and I'm glad I picked this color too, because I feel like this is a very good year-round color. Some may think it's too dark for the upcoming, you know, spring summer season, but I don't, and I will show you why. So I think with this dark beige color, it has enough of the cooler, bluer tones for this to work as a perfect grounding neutral for honestly any color that you would, you know, want to pair it with. It could definitely work for fall. It can handle those heavier, weightier colors like your Bordeaux, your blacks, your deep, deep, dark espresso browns. But this also works with lighter pastels and brights for spring, summer. I'm gonna show you two examples of what I'm kind of talking about or leaning toward. Like I said, I want to use this little bag as my carry-all when it comes to going to all my classes and stuff like that. So this ties together fine. It's not clashing. It works off the browns. It's the same sort of color range. And as you can see, this is a darker, deeper brown, but it's not taking too much away from it. If we add, let's say I want to add this light mauve leather jacket on top of the biker set. Let's say I get a little chilly, and this is what I want to wear out. This ties right into that whole little color story here. So we have lights, darks, and a grounding neutral. So this completely works. Another example is this racerback jumpsuit by Roberto Cavalli that I got a while back. I still have not worn this. I'm determined to wear this spring, summer. But the grounding color of this print is similar to my Teddy Blake bag, which is that dark beige neutral. So this ties in together completely, almost a perfect match. And this is still light enough, I think, for a nice spring, summer look. It's not too heavy to me. And then if I want to bring this into fall, winter, I can of course layer something underneath the jumpsuit. For the pastels, when I first saw the dark beige color, I immediately knew that I wanted to try it with this dusty lavender purple, because I feel like that is a great compliment. This is by Skims. And these work perfect together because they're both kind of that dusty, more muted colors of lavender and beige. So on the color wheel, these would work perfectly together. And for the brights, a good example would be this sunset printed set from Hosbjerg. It's a brand based out of Copenhagen. But there's a lot of different colors going on in this set, but it all ties together. You have your magenta,
your lime, your lemon colors, and then this sort of dark berry. And I mainly picked this as an example because of this dark berry color, this dark purple here. And once again, as I just talked about with the more dusty lavender color in the Skims top, that works well with the dark beige. So this dark beige color would definitely calm this whole outfit and this set down a little bit. So it's not like overloading the eye with just an explosion of just brights. And that's how I would kind of pair this. Instead of doing like, I mean, you could go with a neutral bag, like a white bag or a black bag, but this also adds a little bit of interest too, in my opinion.
I'm definitely going to be styling and wearing both of those things throughout the spring season. It's getting warmer in New York, so I'm excited to start to bring out the spring clothes. Thank you again to Teddy Blake for sending me this bag. I really, really love it, and I can't wait to style it more. You guys will be seeing a lot of this one.